For this talk, I have the modest goal of entirely changing how you view the universe. What better place to start than the first image released to the public from the James Webb Space Telescope? There's a lot going on here, especially with these beautiful arcs. But for our purposes, the most important takeaway is that even if I could attach a giant telescope to you and put you out in space, you would not be able to see this, because this is infrared light. It does nothing to the rod and cone cells of your eyes. In fact, that's the case with most of the light in the universe. As you may know, the light that we can see, the light that does something to the rod and cone cells of your eyes to create a current on your optic nerve and eventually register in your brain that you've seen something, is only a small part of the light that is out there. If you only see a small part of the light that's out there, you're only seeing a small part of what makes the light. So in order to really understand what's going on in the universe, we'll have to use all the kinds of light. We can visualize, pun intended, I suppose, the different kinds of light this way, with what we call the electromagnetic spectrum. Now, as you may know, light is a wave, like waves on the ocean. And so we can characterize it by the wavelength, that is, the distance between the tops of the waves. Shorter wavelength corresponds to higher energy and vice versa. So we can also think about light in terms of energy. Now, in sort of the middle range of the energies here, we have the visible light that our eyes can see, from red on the lowest energy end up through the colors of the rainbow to purple. Now, when you get to purple, if you go to higher energy, it's not that there's no light there. It's just that your eyes can't see it. And so at higher energy than purple, we have what we call ultraviolet light, and beyond that, X-ray light, and beyond that, what we call gamma rays. And then if you go to lower energy than red light, it's not that there's no light there. It's just that your eyes can't see it. And so below red light, we have what we call infrared light, and then microwave light, and then what we call radio waves. Now, with all these different kinds of light having different energies, different processes in the universe will give rise to them. So in order to understand what's going on in the universe at different energy levels, we'll have to be able to study all the different kinds of light. Now, let's look at some examples. First, we'll start with radio light. What I want to show you here is a little small patch of the sky and what it looks like in the visible light that our eyes can see. What you see here are a bunch of little stars and galaxies. And in particular, we're interested in one little galaxy that's in the middle there. Now I want to show you what this same exact little patch of sky looks like in radio light. If you had radio eyes, you would see that. Quite different, right? Now, it turns out what's happening here is we're seeing the effect of a supermassive black hole, billions of times bigger than the sun, in the middle of that galaxy. And it's shooting out matter, which is then glowing in radio waves. Now, one of the things that I work on is studying these systems and figuring out what's been happening with these black holes over the history of the universe. Now, let's have an example from ultraviolet light. I want to show you a picture of a nearby galaxy as it appears in the visible light that our eyes can see. As you see, it's mostly a fuzzy glow. Now we'll look at the same exact galaxy in ultraviolet light. You can see that it's much more concentrated in a few regions, in particular these spiral arms. This is where the hot, short-lived stars are. They're hot, so they're glowing in the higher energy ultraviolet light. These are the stars that do interesting things like explode. Next, let's have an example from X-ray light. And here again, I want to show you what a small patch of the sky looks like, first in the visible light that our eyes can see. What we're looking at here is actually a galaxy cluster. There's about 1,000 galaxies all swimming around each other. And now, we will look at the same exact patch of sky as it looks like in X-ray light. Quite different. You can see a few of the brightest galaxies there, but mostly what you see is a fuzzy glow all around and between the galaxies. What we're seeing here is a lot of hot matter. Hot, so that it has high energy and it's glowing in X-rays, all in between the galaxies there. In fact, this is where most of the ordinary matter, now I'm not even talking about dark matter yet, if you've heard of that, this is where most of the ordinary matter is in the universe. It's in the form of little electrons and protons all flying around between these galaxies and sending out these X-rays. Next, we'll have an example from gamma ray light. And what I want to do here is make a map of the whole sky. So just like we can take the round Earth and make a flat map out of it, and you don't see every little river and stream in detail, but you see the overall picture of how it is. Let's do the same thing with the round sky that surrounds the Earth. And so if we do that in visible light, it looks like this. Now the bright band across the middle there, that's the disk of our galaxy as we're looking through it, the Milky Way. And if you've ever gone out camping on a really dark night in a nice dark place, you might have seen this band across the sky. If not, take my word for it. Now let's look at the same thing, a map of the whole sky, but now in gamma rays. Clearly, there's something quite different going on there. Now, what's causing these bubbles is a topic of some debate. But there must be something going on at the center of our galaxy. Finally, let's bring it back to infrared light and James Webb. What I'm showing you here is a small region of our galaxy as it appears in visible light. You can see a few stars there, but mostly what you're seeing here, what appears to be these curtains sort of blocking the light. Now let's look at that same little bit of the galaxy as it appears in infrared light from James Webb. You can see that the curtains now are mostly transparent, and you're seeing a lot of the stars that were behind the curtains. This tells us that there are regions of dust in our galaxy. The dust is blocking the visible light, but it's letting through the infrared wavelengths. Now, this dust is heavy atoms and molecules. It's the kind of stuff that formed most of the Earth. And so, therefore, it makes up most of you and me and everything we like. Now, the only way to make these heavy atoms and molecules is inside of a really big hot star to have it either blow up really big or explode. So we know that that used to happen a lot. This also tells us that since this is most of what makes up the Earth, most of what makes up the Earth and you and me and everything we like was once inside of a star. And so those were some hopefully pretty examples of how, in order to build up a systematic understanding of what's going on in the universe, we have to use all the kinds of light. Without doing that, we wouldn't know what black holes can do. We wouldn't know what most of the ordinary matter in the universe is up to, and we wouldn't know what makes up a galaxy. So next time you look up at the sky on a dark night or through a telescope someone has set up, think about what you're seeing, but also think about what's there that you can't see. Thank you.